Amen. Amen. God is good. So if you have your Bibles, brothers and sisters, we are back to Deuteronomy. Due to our time, we're not going to move from chapter 1 again today. Although, I need to warn you, I'm falling in love with God's Word. Look at your faces. And this is what happens. I fall in love with God's Word and my preaching gets longer and longer. So, most definitely today, we'll have to split the Word of God and the preaching into half, if I can reach half, and then see next week. So we started a series, for those of you who couldn't make it last week, and I'm sorry, I acknowledge that it has been a difficult time reaching the church due to roadworks and other difficulties, but I named this series Restoring Our Love for God. And there's been a few things that have been going through my mind through the time of holiday. And those of you who missed the first preacher, feel free to go back to our YouTube channel here in church. The preaching will be there for you. You can listen in your own leisure time and try to connect with the first part. And now we will go to the second part. So in the first part of our preaching, I did talk a little bit about the overview of the book of Deuteronomy, its importance, where or to who the book is referring to. And we talked a little bit about its content. And not to go very long, but we determined that the application for us today, Moses is trying to get the people who had faith to move into people who have faith and mission, because the people of God were stuck in their ways. So as we continue today, on board we will not read first, but on board we will have some verses that will come up from time to time that I will be reading there, so you have nothing to worry about. I will only read chapter 2, verse 14, and then I will pray. It will give us a context of where we're going. Chapter 2, verse 14 says this: 38 years passed from the time we left Kadesh Barnea until we crossed the Zered Valley. By then, the entire generation of fighting men had perished from the camp, as the Lord has sworn to them. Lord, as we come to your word now, I pray, O God, that you will prepare our hearts, O Lord, to prepare our minds so we can understand and receive into our heart. Lord, I bless your work that you are doing through your word in our hearts, Lord. May we be encouraged, may we be challenged and formed, because you are the potter. Form us as we need to. Help us grow. Help us get stronger. Learn how to love you. In Jesus' time, I bless this time of your word. Amen. 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 So just recap quickly, brothers and sisters. As I said, when we look at the book of Deuteronomy, what does Moses do? He begins with the flashback. So he starts explaining that God's people are on a brink of entering the promised land, the land that God had promised them. And then Moses says in 1:6, he says this. He basically is reminding them of how we got here. And Moses is going 40 years back by saying this: the Lord our God said to us at the mountain of Horeb, you have stayed long enough at this mountain. And then Moses tells the story of how people rebelled against God. In other words, the people of God refused to trust him. And instead of entering the promised land that God promised them, they wandered around the desert for 40 years. And as I read in verse 14 of chapter 2, in that time, as they are wandering around for the 40 years, all the men who had been fighting age had died. Now, in order to understand that verse, I think we need to assume here, because we don't quite know exactly what the Bible is saying to us. What is the fighting age? So if we were to think perhaps in our own world, maybe we can say a fighting age would be at 18. A lot of things happens in 18, don't they? But if we were to say the age of fighting that they were allowed was 18, if everything over the age of 18 is dead after 40 years. Do you understand what I mean? Because this is what Moses is saying, and this is important for us to understand. From the age of 18, or the fighting age, whatever that is, in the speck of time, or in the time of wandering in desert for 40 years, everyone died on that period. Nobody was over the age of 58 then. There was a lie. Think about that, what that means, brothers and sisters. Everyone over the age of 18, at the time of the Exodus, as they were going out of Egypt, now they would be around the age between 40 and 58. How many of you are in that age? Okay? So, a lot has happened on that age. And actually, if you were to think 40 years back, you may not remember many things that have happened. Some of those things may be quite blurred. What happened 40 years ago? So some of us may have been children or just about being born, and so on and so forth. So everyone over the age of 18 at the time of Exodus that have already died, after the 40 years, the 18 years old were now 58. Is my math still holding up? I think so. And they, according to scripture, would be the oldest in the camp. The oldest people in the camp. All adults who came out of Egypt in the Exodus died in the desert. None of them entered the promised land. Think of the devastation. Think of that. The vast majority of people would be under the age of 40. And all of these people were born in desert. All of them. This, in other words, was a young nation with no one over the age of 60 years old. Except Moses. Except who else? Joshua. Except who else? Caleb. And why do you think these people were still there? Think of that. Moses was over the age of 100. The next oldest guy would have been around 58 years old. Think about the gap in generation. Generation gap that would have been in that camp, brothers and sisters. I actually can resonate with that, because something similar happened in Kosovo. When the war happened, a lot of the older generation was killed, was wiped out. And only the children in many areas of the country were left to survive. And for a while, the country was quite young in age. And thank God that the enemy did not prosper their plans. So I sort of understand when I read this as to what happened here and what it looks like. In the village I've shared before when I was working, there was no male presence. When I went to that place working with children, I was mainly the person, male figure that they had. And that is crazy to even think about, brothers and sisters. And this is the story that's happening amongst God's people here. So now I want us to look a little bit closer back to that verse, chapter 1, verse 6, when Moses says, "The Lord our God said to us at Horeb, you have stayed long enough here." He's talking about what happened 40 years ago. The most of the people weren't even born, and many of the rest were too young to remember. Look with me in some of the verses, again in chapter 1, from verse 26 to verse 32. I'm just going to pick some of the things that Moses says, which I think it sounds a bit strange. He says, "You were unwilling to go up." Then he says, "You rebelled against the Lord." He says, "You grumbled in your tents and said, 'The Lord hates us.' You did not trust in the Lord your God." So these are all the words that Moses is saying. And the question comes, why is Moses saying this to them? If I were there, I would be agitated. I would want to raise my hands and say, "Moses, excuse me for a minute here. Why are you saying this to me? Why these words to me? I was only 12 when these things happened. And most of the rest of us were not even born. Or born yet. All of these things happened to our parents. Why do you think Moses is saying this to this generation? How can he say that we refuse to go up? Why is he saying to them, "We grumbled"? It wasn't them. It was their parents. Why would Moses repeat these things to them? Is he them blaming the children for the sins of their parents? Do you think this is what Moses is trying to do? No, that's right. He's not blaming them. But there is a very important lesson, brothers and sisters, that we need to learn, and I hope we can go through it very quickly. I think Moses is making it very plain to them all. He's trying to teach them that what was in their parents is also in you. There's no difference. What was in their parents is also inside of you. You will face the same temptation. You will face the same struggles that they did. What defeated them, you must overcome in your time and in your life. So Moses, brothers and sisters, is showing them that in order to overcome or to change their future, they need to be owning their past. That's the only way they can move forward. In order for their future to change, they need to own their past. So what is their past? Or what is our past that we must own, brothers and sisters? what was in their parents by nature that they must overcome. But Moses is trying to teach them. So we can go by thinking of impulses of our nature, because this is what Moses is trying to bring to the fore. And there's six different things through the scriptures that we are going to go through that Moses wants to raise awareness to these people. The first thing that he wants to raise the awareness of is in verse 26. Moses wants to show them that by nature we are rebels against God. Verse 26 says, you were unwilling to go up. You rebelled against the command of the Lord your God. What this means is that our corruption, the effect of sin in us, goes deeper than a few sins and mistakes. By nature, I resent God. By nature, I resist His authority over my life. By nature, I want to assert my independence from God. I want to be my own savior. I want to be my own Lord. Wouldn't you say that's sort of true with us? The second thing, in verse 27, Moses wants to show them the impulse. By nature, we treat God with contempt. Verse 27 says, you grumbled in your tents and said, the Lord hates us. So he brought us out of Egypt to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites and destroy us. Think of this, how crazy this is. The deliverance from Egypt was an extraordinary miracle of God's grace. Amen? And these people are treating God's grace with contempt. Sin makes them so twisted that they see God's miraculous deliverance as God plotting against them. And brothers and sisters, I want to say this is me. This is you. By nature, we hold back praise from God's goodness and tend to blame Him whenever we experience evil. By nature, we too will say, here I am in the desert and it's all God's fault. He made me do this. He made me be where I am. By nature, it's within us to insult God and treat His goodness with contempt. Number three, brothers and sisters, that we see Moses speaking about, he says, by nature, you tend to blame others. Verse 28. Our brothers have made us lose heart. They say the people are stronger and taller than we are. When the spies came back from Canaan, 10 of them said that it would be too difficult to conquer the land. And what do the people do? They blame the spies. It's all their fault. By nature, I will always blame others for all of my problems. What's wrong is always somebody else's fault. It's by nature. Also, isn't that what Jesus said? That you find it very easy to find a speck in my sister's and my brother's eye and forget to actually see the plank, the piece of wood that's sticking out of mine. It's by nature inside of you to blame others for your own wrongdoing. And then number four, that Moses wants to teach them in verse 29 to 31, brothers and sisters. By nature, we resist the truth. Moses said to people, "Do not be terrified. Do not be afraid of them. The Lord your God, who is going before you, will fight for you as he did in Egypt." And in the desert, Moses, as a man of God, is pleading with his people. They are full of fear, so he's speaking as a prophet. Moses pours out the word of God into their lives. But, sad to say, it makes no difference. These people hear the word of God, but it seems to slide off them like water in smooth surface. It doesn't go in. It makes no difference. In verse 32, Moses says, "In spite of this, you did not trust in the Lord your God." We may always be seeing God at work, but never perceive it. We have witnessed God's hand in our life, testimonies after testimonies, but yet we struggle to perceive it. And number five, brothers and sisters, in verse 32, by nature we refuse to believe. "You did not trust the Lord your God, who went ahead of you." It is within our nature to be suspicious of God and to hold back from full devotion to him. It's within our nature to not trust him. God was beside these people in the pillar of cloud and in fire, and yet they still did not trust him. They refused to believe. You can find this story in Numbers chapter 14, and this particular is in verse 11. None of us are neutral when it comes to this matter of faith. It's by nature that we are, antagonistic before or towards God. And so are you. It is by nature that we are unwilling to believe in God. And the last one we find in verse 34. By nature, I am under the wrath of God. When the Lord heard what you said, he was angry and sorely swore, "Not a man of this evil generation will see the land I swore to your forefathers," which we find in Deuteronomy 1:34. And brothers and sisters, doesn't the scripture teach us of this in the New Testament also? That it is by nature that we are too alienated from God and justly under his wrath. There is heaven, yes, but by nature it's not for me, or it's not for you. By nature, I have no basis to which to enter the land of promise that is full of good things. So this is Moses saying, all that was in your parents, but don't think it stops with them. All of this is in you. And it's also in us. When you think of a human condition, what I just said, brothers and sisters, it makes you weak, doesn't it? This is a human condition. It is by nature that we are in this condition, with no one, with any exception whatsoever. This is who you are. And this is what crosses all boundaries, economic and social boundaries. This is what sin has done to us. This is what you and I need saving from. This is what we battle every day. Can you see yourself? Maybe you are saying right now, I see it. I see that I have totally messed up. I see that I have rebelled against God. I see that I have treated God with contempt. I see that I blame others for what's wrong in my life. I see that I have resisted the truth. I see that I have refused to believe. And I see that I am under the wrath of God. So what hope is there for me? Everything that kept you from, or kept your parents going to Canaan, is also in you. That's what Moses is teaching them. And what hope is there for us, brothers and sisters? What hope was there for them to enter the promised land? I'm going to end here, but let me just say there is a brighter future. There is hope in Jesus Christ. The next thing that I will be saying in that sermon is what we find in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 2 and 3, where Moses reminds them all that God made a covenant. And he says that covenant was not for your forefathers, but that covenant is for you as well. God made a covenant before you were born. And guess what, brothers and sisters? God has made a covenant before you here today were born. And that covenant is through the blood of Jesus Christ, to what we celebrated today. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for all that you teach us. Lord, we are fallen human beings. Lord, we acknowledge that we have a battle to face daily. But God, we have hope because we can see of what you have done for us. We can see and we can hold to the covenant that you have set for us, where love can be felt, where freedom can be gained, and life lived with you is possible. Thank you, Lord, for the work that you are doing and you've done for our lives. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise be to God. Hallelujah. We're going to sing a love song, brothers and sisters, and if you are able to stand and you need to stand to stretch, feel free to do so. This one's going to be online, and we will be looking at 10,000 reasons why to praise the Lord. Let's stand and sing together.